Remember that old saying, be kind, rewind? Well, last week, folks, thanks again, all of our fans were kind, and they did listen to Retro Wrestling Rewind. You thought episode number one was great. You ain't seen nothing yet. Episode number two, which we cover World-Class Championship Wrestling's Parade of Champions, begins now. Welcome in to the second episode of Retro Wrestling Rewind. As always, I am one half of the Retro Wrestling Podcast Tag Team Champions. I am David Fine, alongside my tag team partner, at least for this show, Alex G-Man. We covered WrestleMania last week. We decided to go to World Class Championship Wrestling for this edition. I know you have a story about the Von Erich, you know, the only living Von Erich. What did he do? He did something special on your retro video games channel.
Yeah. So hi, glad to be back once again. Nice to hear from you as always. So apparently, Kevin Von Erich is a fan of the NWA 1983 project and retro wrestling. Retro Wrestling Games, the YouTube channel, and on one of the episodes, we were talking about how I felt that Vince McMahon in 1983 was super hot on the Von Erichs. He desperately wanted them to come to the WWF, and that's just based on the television. The strange thing about TV, and I think everyone knows how Vince is, right? He's very, like, controlling of everything, right? So in 1983... he gets on All American Wrestling, he gets on USA Network, he has that show, and he goes out to all the other promoters and like, hey guys, I have a national platform, send me some of your tapes of some of your top guys, and I'll air them on my show, and we'll get them more over and what have you. So what he did essentially was he picked guys that he was about to bring in anyway. So we saw like Hulk Hogan, we saw JYD, like all the guys that he wanted to bring in as kind of a like to prime his audience for guys that he was going to steal in the future, which is a brilliant move on his end. So one of the matches featured was Von Erich's match. It was like, oh, that's interesting. In addition, when the WWF magazine finally got rolled out, they did a whole big article on the Von Erichs, which is very strange because Vince doesn't like talking about wrestlers outside his own territory.
Yeah.
And he's talking about guys that haven't come in yet, you know, and he's really, like, really putting over the Von Erichs huge. In addition to that, when David passed away, he did a 10-bell salute for him on television.
Which is, I mean, that's, I mean, that means he kind of acknowledged other promotions. So.
Yeah, and that's something that he rarely did. And he, you know, until recently, he started doing that a little bit more now, but that's something that he didn't do for like 25, 30 years at all. If it wasn't WWF, it didn't exist.
No, I mean, it's one of those things that we, you know, in the past, Vince is not, I mean, he never acknowledged the NWA, I mean, until they brought the big gold belt, yeah, you know, over there. But I mean,
even that, he didn't really acknowledge it either. He said that. You know, he was the real world champion, and I'm like, even the Gorilla was like, we don't know where he won that belt from. We don't even know if it's legitimate or not. Like,
yeah. What's going on here? But, yeah, I mean, this show, I mean, what were your thoughts of this show? I mean, it was...
Let's go back to your... I want to read the message here. So after I stated that on my show, Kevin Von Erich actually DM'd me via Twitter, and this is the message that he left me. Just picture Kevin Von Erich saying this. My father was by far the best NWA president. Wrestling under Sam Muskin was the golden era. Wrestling shows were held in ballrooms while having dinner, and the fans wore suits. St. Louis was the best of all. I was a toddler, but I remember it well. Vince McMahon Sr. was, in my dad's words, the only other man in the NWA that his word was a contract. My father wouldn't have said this if he wasn't a good man. Both men stood out. My father was unanimously elected to replace Sam when the time came. I was also at the meeting in Vegas where Vince Jr. brought his attorney to tell the promoters that having territories was illegal and no one's ever brought an outsider like that. afterwards promoted hated Vince so much they couldn't see straight. Hold on, I gotta scroll down. Vince offered to give my father one half of the business if we would come up and take Hogan's place. Vince's office didn't trust him to stay loyal, but knew we would. My father refused, and I was the only one that wanted to hear him out. We met at the old AmFac Hotel in the early days of the DFW airport. Our TV ratings were so impressive that we doubled our nearest competitor, dominated the hut level, homes using television, and every other aspect back in the early days. There were two, the Nielsen and the Arbitron ratings. No one would ever duplicate the numbers that WCCW pulled up.
Back in the day, back when ratings, when you only got like three channels, they were definitely the...
I think a lot of people overlooked the Von Erichs national syndication package that they had. You were able to see them in a lot of places. And also, they had international distribution. So that's why the Von Erichs were so over in Israel. Mm-hmm. And they would do tours of Israel like all the time. And even when Kevin goes back, I see it on his Twitter all the time that he's like a rock star in Israel. So they were really big places, in places outside of Dallas. And I have a feeling that they were about to go national too. Everyone was going to go national. Mid-South was prepping to go national. Vern Gagne was prepping to go national. Fritz was about to go national. So I think it was just a case that Vince just did it first. he had all his ducks in a row and was ready to roll. Because he did a lot of work in 82. And when they first expanded into Los Angeles was the first territory that it went into that was outside the core WWF market. They kind of partnered with the LaBelles a little bit and eventually to kind of just force them out anyway. So wrestling overall, if you look at 1984, and I think this particular show, Parade of Champions, the first ever David Von Erich Memorial Show, is the end of the NWA as it was prior to that. And the reason why I say that is because this is the last time that someone outside of Jim Crockett Promotions would win the NWA World's Heavyweight Championship. After Flair beats Kerry in Japan to win the belt back, that's it. It's all Crockett guys from here on out until they sell the WCW.
Yeah, the NWA kind of went to crap. But then, of course, recently with all the kind of the new blood and the new energy pumped into the NWA, which, we'll be talking about later on. But it's just, the show, it's the first ever David Von Erich, Memorial Show. There was 50,123 people there, and it said it was 43,517 paid. But have you noticed once you go to this, first, second, third edition of this of the Parade of Champions, the attendance just goes down? Do you think the reason the high attendance that we had at the first one is because it was kind of a first time they've done it, and people were just super pumped?
No, I don't think it's that. I think there's two things going on here. Number one, this is kind of, let's pay respect to David, first of all, right? And I think it pulled in a lot of people. I know a lot of local celebrities were at their show as well. It was a big freaking deal. In addition, this is the peak of their hottest period in the promotion's history. You're coming off the Von Erich Freebird feud. Like, this is kind of the end of phase one of that feud. They would come back and forth, and I think the Freebirds would go elsewhere, and then eventually would go to the WWF for like 3 days, and they would leave. But I don't think it was ever as hot as it was at this point. This is kind of the end of that particular phase of this feud. So you have the Von Erich Freebird feud. You have Fritz coming out of retirement, big deal. This is Kerry. I think everyone basically knew that Kerry was winning the belt here. I mean, it was pretty much plain plain to everyone to see. Because if Kerry doesn't win the belt, the promotion's dead. It's gone. It's finished.
Yeah, I mean,
because none of the Von Erich boys have won the championship up until this point. And they've always, they have had draws with Harley Race, a lot of other stuff that would happen. And David was promised a run this year. So he passes away, doesn't get to have that run. And it would have been like a 2-week run anyway. Let's be honest here, because Flair just wins it in the Flair for the Gold in Starrcade 83. We're talking about May of 84.
Yeah, I mean,
he just wins the belt in November of 83.
I mean, it was kind of like, I mean, I'm kind of, fast forwarding to Saturday night at All In. It was kind of people knew going in that Cody, was going to win the belt. It's kind of like going in.
It's right for business. You could tell.
Yeah, it's right for business.
It's WWE when they don't do the right thing.
No.
They could be okay. You can't do the wrong things.
No.
In these situations and be successful.
And it's kind of like with this. It's a memorial for his brother. Flair's going to, agree to drop the title. I mean, it's –
if Kerry loses?
I don't think Flair makes it out alive.
They kill him.
That place would have. I mean, they hated Flair enough, but good Lord! I mean, and back then, they didn't have any really guardrails. They had like ropes. They like it's like that's not gonna hold anybody back. If you don't give the belt to him,
this is Dallas, people. Come on,
at Texas Stadium on a memorial show for his brother. I mean, on Saturday when Cody won the NWA title from Nick Aldis. I mean. It was a great. I mean, it was now it's the first ever father son combo to ever held the NWA title, and that was awesome. But yeah, I mean, you're going to give the title to the brother of the guy you're a memorial for. I mean, he may not keep the belt on him for a long time, but you're at least going to give it to him and have that kind of pop him circumstance. But
he needed the win.
He definitely
needed the win for Texas. He needed the win for world class. He needed the win for his family.
Yeah, I mean, he definitely needed that. Let's kind of go down the show if you want to. It was a good show. It wasn't as long as
this is a prototypical world class show.
Yeah.
Now you got to understand a couple of things here. Number one, world class roster historically has always been very small.
Yeah.
I think they run 12 guys and that's it. And they actually had to bring in some other guys. I don't think Butch Reed was working world class. I think he was from Mid-South.
Yeah.
And with JYD.
And I'm not sure. I actually worked with this guy who was actually against Butch Reed, Chick Donovan, who actually still wrestles.
He's a talking dog. You know that?
He's what?
He's a talking dog. That's what he tells people.
Well, I mean, he says a lot of things, but it's funny. I saw him recently.
Dusty Rhodes hates Chick Donovan, by the way.
Well, I mean,
I don't know why. I was watching a shoot interview with Dusty the other day, mm-hmm. and he goes on for about like 6 or 7 minutes just burying Chick Donovan. They weren't even asking about Chick. He was just burying him for no reason.
And the funny thing is, he looks exactly like he did back then today, except he's 60 years older. I mean, he's got the same.
I loved him in Memphis. I thought he was great.
He's got the same. I'm sure that's not his natural hair color, blonde. But let's just kind of go down the card. We had Kelly Kaniski or Kaniski.
Kelly Kaniski, the son of the former NWA World Champion.
He wrestled Johnny Mantell to a time limit draw. It's one of those matches that I was watching the whole. I watched the show. You watched the show entirely, from start to finish. I watched it on
actually my version had the first two matches cut, so I had to go back and watch it on the network.
Yeah, I had to watch it on the network because they didn't have the whole show in order. They had it on their weekly show, so it's kind of back and forth. So I must have glazed over that match if they even
No, it was your prototypical like two young guys, almost a typical like light heavyweight match for the time. It's not like Dynamite Kid.
But the funny thing is, according to Wikipedia, and you always should believe Wikipedia, this match went 15 minutes, but the main event, Kerry Von Erich and Ric Flair, went 11 minutes and 24 seconds. Yeah. Why would they give, unless they ran out of time like they did at All In, but that's neither here.
I don't think so. I think the World Class shows were also very short.
Yeah, I mean the Butch. Yeah, I mean some of these matches were like 4 minutes 23 seconds.
They didn't have like those guys that can go. Yeah. I mean, other than the Von Erich boys, that can go an hour.
They don't have
guys like that. Like that Kamala's not going an hour.
Kamala's not going. We had the second match. We had Chris Adams. I don't know if he was a gentleman at the time. And Sunshine, they defeated one of the future Freebirds, Jimmy Garvin, and his lovely valet/wife, Precious, and a mixed tag team match.
An angle that kind of branches off the Jimmy Garvin versus David Von Erich angle they were doing is basically Jimmy Garvin was with Sunshine first, right? Mm-hmm. So that was his valet, right?
Yeah.
And then he felt that Sunshine was being overworked, so he got a valet for his valet, which is ridiculous. And eventually, they have problems and whatever, and they fight. And there's this famous segment where where like Bill Mercer goes to Jimmy Garvin's house and like Fresh is there, and like you can tell like what they were doing beforehand. Uh-huh. It was hilarious. It was fantastic. This is Chris Adams. Like this is young Chris Adams too. He's really moving. He's really working. You know, he's doing that super kick at the time. So I really like this match, and it's you don't see a whole lot of mixed tags very often in this era. They happen, but not a whole lot. Not to the extent that you see them now.
Yeah, I mean, you don't see a lot of women's wrestling back then. And if you did, it was like in Glow and, you know, kind of those.
It'd be like whatever Moolah's girls are coming out, like Velvet McIntyre versus Wendy Richter or some sort of.
Yeah. It was a good match for what it was. I mean, you know, it's. I mean, I'm a big fan of Jimmy Garvin, Precious, you know, because they had the run on the.
I love Jimmy Garvin pre-Freebirds. I think the stuff with the Freebirds. I don't know when the Freebirds became the world's greatest rock and roll band, but whenever they did is when I stopped liking them.
Hey, but on the show, well, yeah, I was on the show. They had the premiere of Bad Street USA, so that was another first. They said, "Hey,
did anyone else sing other than Michael Hayes?"
No,
Gordy's not singing.
No, and one of the guys that I'm good friends with who does some stuff with Jimmy or with Michael Hayes right now. He was not in this era of when they had the Bad Street, but yeah, I thought it was a good song, and but I think the only person who actually sang was Michael Hayes.
Because they had the second song, mm-hmm. WCW, like in 91-92.
Yeah.
and I think it's called I'm a Free Bird, but what is your excuse?
Yeah, and if you watch the network, most of the songs they are, you know, they take off and they put generic music. I'm not sure if they kept the Freebirds theme song in it. I think they did
because I think Michael owns it.
Yeah, yeah.
He recently released an album like a couple of years back. It was like a Christian rock album.
Yeah, I mean,
which is interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Michael Hayes.
Yeah, I have a couple of stories about Michael Hayes that that I've heard and from you know, as they would say, rumor and innuendo.
Probably all true.
Trust me, I know they're all true.
They're probably not good for mixed audiences.
They're not good. They're not good for mixed audiences. But moving on, speaking of the oldest youth in America, Chick Donovan, he lost to Butch Reed, who of course, as you know, became the famous second half of the duo Doom in WCW. What were your thoughts on this match? It went 4 minutes and 23 seconds. It was, I mean, you blink your eye, it was over.
I love Butch Reed. I'm a big Butch Reed fan. He's amazing. I met him like 2 years ago, and he was awesome. I think at the time, you know, between his look, his ability to work, he had these fantastic matches with Ric Flair, whether it be in Mid-South or in Florida. He had he was the number one babyface, you know, after JYD leaves for the WWF for a while, and you know he was supposed to be Intercontinental Champion, but he didn't show up to that show because he's Butch Reed, and they gave it to the Honky Tonk Man instead. So that's a rumor, by the way. I don't know if that's legitimate.
Hey, the Raw Honky Tonk Man, the world's greatest Intercontinental Champion, yeah. Just asked Jimmy Hart. He will tell you that he is the world's greatest. He is, and. This match,
But Butch Reed overall, I mean, this match is, it's essentially, for the most part, a squash match.
Yeah.
But it really did, you know, you really did see all of, you know, Butch Reed's offense here. I love that flying shoulder tackle from the top rope. It's amazing.
Yeah, I mean,
he probably needed if he got, like, there was always reliability issues with Butch. And much like Sid Vicious, who loved his softball, Butch Reed loves the rodeo, and that's what he does in his spare time. So he was like, I'm leaving this promotion because I'm going to work at the rodeo.
Do you think he's a better singles wrestler than a tag team wrestler?
Yeah. I mean, at the time, you're talking about, this is the tail end of kind of Butch Reed's career when he was a tag team, so that was a good spot for him as it was.
Yeah.
But you're talking about throughout the 80s, he's a fantastic singles wrestler. He had a pretty good run in WWF, too.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, he could have been the world's greatest Intercontinental Champion, but
he could. He was on my. He's on my short list of guys that could have been NWA World Champion, other than Ric Flair. in the 80s. Like, I have a 20 person list of people other than Ric Flair that could have been world champion.
And you think he could have been better than Ron Simmons?
Yeah.
As champion?
He was better worker. He's better working than Ron, that's for sure. He's not a better promo, though.
Yeah.
But he's a better worker.
Yeah, I mean, definitely.
But he could have had those matches that Ron couldn't have.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think Ron can go 30 minutes.
Well, I mean, I don't know if Ron can go 30 minutes. I know Brock Lesnar can't go 30 minutes, but...
He can't go 3 minutes.
Well, no, he can't walk to the ring without getting purple. I mean, when we're at WrestleMania 30, I was concerned. He walked to the ring, he was purple. But, you know...
Did everyone in the first row pass out of lack of oxygen because Brock was breathing so heavy?
I mean, thank God he's not Universal Champion anymore. Hopefully he'll just...
Nobody's not listening.
You know what? If he's listening, I wish he was listening. You know that, because you know what, that would be great. It's kind of like, you know, having a celebrity listen to us. But moving on, we had Kamala with the great Skandar Akbar, and Friday he wrestled to a double disqualification against the great Kabuki.
I don't remember this angle very well. If someone's listening, can tell us, because to me, everyone here is a heel.
Yeah.
Well, Skandar Akbar was a heel, I believe, at this time. I don't think he was a babyface. I don't think he was ever a babyface. If he was, it was much later.
No, and speaking of...
Gary Hart was never a babyface, and Kabuki is a heel. I don't know what's going on.
And speaking of Skandar Akbar, we, of course, talked about him on the previous edition of Retro Wrestling Rewind, because he was the one who he came to the ring with the great Sergeant Slaughter.
So. No, General Agnar.
I get them all mixed up, you know. I mean, I guess that sounds. I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't say that. But anyway, I mean, I don't understand with two heels going against each other.
It could have been a situation. I'm gonna assume here that they were probably a tag, and they bumped into each other, and they're both like pretty much like they're supposed to be monsters, right?
Yeah.
And it kind of makes more sense if you have two monsters who don't get along versus like, oh, two regular, like if it's Gino and Chris as heels kind of fighting each other. But these are two guys, you know, Kamala's essentially a savage and Kabuki is Kabuki. And I can see them not liking each other. I went to this qualification. It lasted 12 minutes, too, which I'm surprised. Yeah. You know what I'm surprised about looking at this card overall? There's no Abby on this show, and there's no Brody on this show.
Yeah, I mean, you would think they would. I mean, when I thought of world-class championship wrestling, I think of Bruiser Brody.
I agree. He must have been in Japan.
And yeah, and Abby must have, you know.
Probably been with him at the time.
Yeah, he probably was with him at the time. And then the next match, I mean, two guys, I mean, there are a lot of people who are not fans of Junkyard Dog. I mean, I was a fan of his in the WWF. He defeated the Missing Link by disqualification. The Missing Link, he is, besides Abdul the Butcher, he was probably the one wrestler back in my youth that would probably scare me if they just appeared.
Scary dude.
Yeah, I mean.
What kind of sticks out in this match, is again we have the Missing Link, who's a monster, and he's going against Junkyard Dog. Junkyard Dog is, Mid South. I think Link was in Mid South too, if I recall correctly. Guys, don't crucify me on this because it's 1984 and everyone is everywhere, and they switch promotions on a 6-week basis, so it's hard to keep track of these things. I like Junkyard Dog pre 86 maybe.
Yeah.
Like when he was a better worker, and that's even given a better worker than he would become. Although he was never the greatest worker of all time. Ric Flair always tells the story. He's like, I hate wrestling the JYD. He sucks.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Dave Meltzer calls him the junk food dog, by the way.
Well, we don't know. We know Dave Meltzer doesn't have the best judgment in saying things, especially on Twitter now. I mean, it's... Anyway,
he's playing a character. You don't get it? You don't get it?
Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Well, he's playing a jackass, but that's beside the point. Hope he's listening. I'll tweet him and say, "Hey, why don't you listen to this episode? I called you a jackass," and then he'll talk about us, and then he'll get his people to listen. But that's beside the point.
I love Uncle Dave, by the way.
Hey, he's no Bill Abner, which actually good friends.
You know, the basis of all my wrestling knowledge is based on Pro Wrestling Illustrated, and I was saddened to find out that the entire thing was a work.
What? Yeah. Was it, what? Oh my God. It's like saying there's no Santa Claus. I mean,
I know. It's like, you mean those interviews they would have with the wrestlers? Those had to be real. Nope.
What?
I was very saddened when I was 13 years old.
I'm going to talk to Bill Abner about that and say, hey, you know what? I just found out that it was all a work. You know what? You know, I can't believe in anything anymore.
It's, you know, the PWI 500 just came out.
Yes, and who was the number one?
Omega.
Kenny Omega.
I'm still not putting him over AJ Styles. I'm sorry.
I worked a promotion that AJ was working at the same time, and good dude, but it's like, he's got that, I call it the soccer haircut, the soccer mom haircut. He just
needs... I mean, yeah, he looks ridiculous. I mean, I'm not saying that.
You think he's better than Kenny Omega?
Yes, and here's why.
Uh-oh.
You look at the quality of opponents.
Uh-huh.
You know, you list all AJ Styles opponents that he had and the good matches he got out of them.
Yeah.
And you look at Kenny Omega and the quality of workers that he worked with this year.
Uh-huh.
AJ Styles carried a lot of those guys to really good matches.
Yeah.
You know, and Kenny was basically, for the most part, wrestling guys that was pretty close to his own level.
Yeah, I mean, that was true. But, I mean, I think...
like, is Kenny going to get that kind of match at Roman Reigns? I don't know.
No.
I don't know.
I mean, well, we're going to see that they have another match. They have Alpha versus Omega 2 for Kenny Omega and Chris Jericho. But
Chris Jericho is amazing. He's the ageless wonder.
Yeah. Well, actually, we're going to talk about that on our All In recap show, which is coming up soon. But we're going to keep on going with this World Class Championship Wrestling from May 6th of 1994, which some of our listeners may have not been born back then. So. You know what, folks? Back in 1984, there was actually good wrestling. And here's a couple more matches. We had Rock and Soul, Buck Zumoff, and Iceman King Parsons.
What the hell is Buck Zumoff doing in World Class? He's supposed to be in the AWA. I wonder what's happening here.
I mean, it's like...
Isn't he in prison? I'm pretty sure he's in prison right now.
Currently, like right now?
Like the second he's in prison.
Well, I mean, he probably is, and then...
Yeah, 25 years in prison.
Oof. Yeah. I don't want... Did he kill somebody, or did he do something illegal?
Criminal sexual conduct.
Huh. Well, we'll move on with that. well, he was actually a wrestler, I'm not surprised, but Iceman King Parsons, they defeated the Super Destroyers, which were Scott Irwin and Bill Irwin. They beat him for... it was a tag match for the NWA American Tag Team Championships.
I wonder if Scott is wrestling with cancer at this point, because he wrestled with cancer. His own entire, you know, treatment until he passed away. I wonder if he has it here.
I mean, he may, because, I mean, you know, sometimes you don't know that you have it, or you have it and you just don't tell anybody, because it's just
He dies in 87, so.
Yeah, I mean, so it's a couple of years.
I don't know.
He may. What were your thoughts on this match?
Typical World Class tag team match. I mean, that's not the Midnight Express, by the way. They come in next year, the following year, 85.
Yes.
I like Iceman King Parsons a lot. I like Scott Irwin a lot. I do not like Buck Zumoff at all. And Bill Irwin is not the greatest worker in the world. So.
Wow. So you give this, Dave Meltzer would say, you give this a rating of a minus two?
Not that low. Okay. There's nothing on the show that's that low. Penises in it.
Yeah, so. I mean, we'll move on from that match. Next match, we had Kevin, Mike, and Fritz Von Erich defeating the fabulous Freebirds of Michael Hayes, Terry Gordy, and Buddy Roberts. It was for the NWA World Six-Man Tag Team Championship, which they didn't seem to have belts back then for the six-man titles. They had it in NWA, and then... regular NWA, I'm not sure. They had a trophy, but what were your thoughts of this match? I mean, it was right before the main event. You know, Kevin, Mike, and Fritz. Of course, Fritz is the father. He came out of retirement to get in this match. What were your thoughts on this match?
Can we talk about for a second how stiff the Von Erichs are? Holy crap, I watch their matches, and it's like, oh, wow. Like, they're laying it in. The Freebirds are also laying it in as well. It's like, because of the way that World Class is produced, and they had the best production at the time, they would continue to have the best production until 1987, by the way, with the way their cameras were set up, the lighting, all that kind of good stuff.
Yeah.
Like, to me, it's like, they really laid that in
And these guys are legitimate tough guys. The Von Erichs, all of them, are just tough as nails. I saw a, I guess they would call it a country whippings match, where it's Hayes and Gordy taking on two of the Von Erichs. And they are wearing each other out with those straps. It was insane. So, you know, seeing Fritz back, not, you know, he's way past his prime era. And these guys are selling for him like, yeah, he's Vern Gagne or something. Jesus. That's my criticism of the AWA. The AWA have all these young jacked up guys who would be selling for like guys who are in their 60s and looked ridiculous. And this is kind of the same thing here. But, you know, Fritz is a tough dude too. I mean, you know, what can you say? I mean, this match is a great match. I don't think this was the Loser Leaves Town match, because I think that happens later on this year, because I think that's a cage match.
Yeah.
But nice to see, nice to see this feud kind of, another chapter in this particular feud. And, Mike, I think everyone just feels bad for Mike Von Erich, because he's probably the least of the Von Erich workers. And it's like, why is he there?
Yeah, and it's, it's one of those things that, it's kind of like the Von Erich curse. It's like, everyone seems, only one left. It's like
one left, and I think everyone forgets about Jackie too. Jackie was the first son who died, I think, when he was really young, maybe like 5 or 6 years old.
But yeah, I'm not sure how, if he died, if like natural causes, but it's like,
I think he was electrocuted in a puddle or something.
It's just like, geez, like it's like guy, you don't want to have your last name.
I have a friend of mine that calls it the curse of Stu Hart, because apparently Fritz Von Erich was trained by Stu Hart.
Well, yeah.
I'm like, no, that has nothing to do with Stu. What are you saying?
Yeah, and one, and actually, I think there are two Von Erichs left. Lacey Von Erich.
Well, that's Carrie's daughter.
Oh yeah, so. Carrie's daughter. So it's like,
well, yeah, because Kevin has two sons. They're currently working right now too. So
do they use the name Von Erich?
Yeah, they do.
Well,
they just wrestled yesterday at the a college football game in Texas, I guess after the show was over in the stadium, they wrestled there.
Oh, God.
I don't know why then they made their way into any kind of, I guess, notable indie promotions or NXT. I don't know why they're not there yet. I haven't really seen them work all that much. I don't know if they can or cannot. I'm assuming they can here.
Yeah,
I'm assuming they have to get some... they have to get some experience underneath their belts.
Yeah, and speaking of experience, the main event saw Kerry Von Erich defeating the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and of course, in a singles match for the NWA World's Heavyweight Title, 11 minutes and 24 seconds. What were your thoughts on this main event at Parade of Champions?
This is probably, in my opinion, might be Kerry's best match
mm-hmm.
That he's had, at least that we can see on videotape.
Yeah,
Kerry's a very good worker when he's in there with the right guys, and he can really be not that great when he's in there with the wrong guys.
Yeah,
Flair can work with anyone; he can make anyone look good. And I think Flair had his working boots on tonight. And it goes to show you kind of the overall greatness of Ric Flair here.
Yeah,
and for him to be kind of doing the right thing, he didn't have to do the right thing here. He could have hemmed and hawed; he would have went back to Jim Crockett and like, hey, I just won the belt. How come I'm cutting my run so short? But either the right thing here.
I mean,
the Flair Von Erich feud, especially mostly with Kevin, with Kerry, because they do all, the Freebird feud is built from a Kerry Von Erich, Ric Flair steel cage match in December of 82. That's when Gordy slams the door on Kerry while Michael Hayes was the referee. So it kind of brings everything back full circle here, because again, Flair is very instrumental, in kind of the beginning of the Von Erich's Freebird feud. So it's nice to see him back on the card here. Again, it's great to see Kerry winning the belt here. It was the right thing to do for the promotion. It's the right thing to do for the Von Erich family. It's the right thing to do for the state of Texas, literally. And although Flair won it back 10-14 days later, in Japan,
it was still the right thing for him to do.
It was the right thing to do in terms of business. And they drew this, phenomenal house, 50,000 people, 1984. I don't know if that's the biggest live attendance that year. It probably is.
Yeah,
I mean, overall, and Starrcade didn't do that big. WWF doesn't have any Shea Stadium shows that year, so I have to assume in North America, to be clear, that this was the biggest event attendance-wise for the year.
Yeah.
So nice to see, you know, Kevin Von Erich and Kerry Von Erich and Ric Flair on top here.
Yeah. So overall, what would you give this this entire show from, you know, 1 to 10? What would your ratings be here on this parade?
I'll be around a 6 because, again, there's no other feuds here other than the Chris Adams, Jimmy Garvin, and the Von Erich stuff.
Yeah.
With the Freebirds. Mm-hmm. The rest of the card is pretty light at best, but this is kind of your prototypical world-class card.
Yeah.
So it's probably like if you're going to say in terms of world-class, it's probably like a 9. In terms of all the other promotions that were around, it was probably closer to a 6.
Yeah, I mean, I would give it probably, I'd say a 5. I mean, it wasn't, you know, it's probably a lot better than the card we're going to be covering next week, but it's... You know, I give it a 5 out of 10.
I think when it comes down to why this show is important, I think for me, is number one, what they drew was 50,000 people. It was the David Von Erich Memorial Show, which we'll go into the circumstances around his death in a minute. And I think it was the NWA's last stand. This is our last big show like this, doing 50,000 people, and the NWA. You know, it wouldn't be all at once. It's not like a clear line of demarcation. Mm-hmm. But after this, it's like it starts to slide a lot. And it already started to slide, but this is kind of the peak of world class, because I don't think they're doing this number ever again either. And they start to go down. I mean, by the time you get to 1987, they're doing 5,900 people in the same venue. So it's like,
yeah, I mean, it's one of those things, you know, it's like, you know, I mean, the attendance went down. But speaking of that, you wanted to talk about the death of David Von Erich to kind of finish off this week's edition of Retro Wrestling Rewind. I mean, what were your thoughts on that? I mean, it's tragic.
I think it's the first real big wrestling national tragedy like this. Like, there's been guys who've died in the ring, Iron Mike DiBiase, you know, and other people as well that, you know, have passed away. But I think overall, this is the first one where, like, it seemed like everyone was mourning this, and it was a big deal. Now, in terms of his death, he died in Japan when he was on tour for All Japan Pro Wrestling. This is February 10th, 1984. And even the circumstances regarding how he died are conflicting. The Von Erichs themselves claim it was a ruptured intestines.
You're not thinking that?
No, because according to Bruiser Brody, Brody, who was there and kind of removed the evidence of that there were painkillers and drugs in his room, because he didn't want them to, you know, he was very protective of the Von Erichs in general. So Flair's the one that says that Bruiser Brody removed the evidence. It's a possible thing. Some people say it was a heart attack. Some people say it was bulimia. It's, again, when you're getting a lot of different stories, like, that's a red flag. There's smoke, there's fire there. So I've heard people say it was the Yakuza that killed them. You know what I mean? I see all kinds of crazy theories like that.
Yeah.
I don't think we'll ever know for sure, unless we, I guess, get an autopsy done.
Yeah.
At this point, which is not going to happen and probably shouldn't happen. But I think this is something that, you know, young guy, you know, super young guy, could have been one of the biggest stars. Like, he was 25 when he passed away. You know, he would have been right there in the Attitude Era with everyone else.
Yeah,
like, I mean, he's around the same age as Bret Hart.
Yeah, I mean, he could have, like you said, he could have, you know, gone to WWF at the time. And
like, he could have went there. I wonder why Kevin didn't go in the early 90s when Kerry went. I wonder if there's something there too.
There, I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, hearsay, And no one's ever going to know.
Yeah, David was promised the NWA World title. He was the best worker out of the Von Erichs. And for what people say, he had the best wrestling mind. So I think it's fair to assume that Fritz would have retired, put David in charge of World Class, and then maybe, with a little forward thinking, having the young guy, that the World Class Championship Wrestling may have survived, possibly, with David as the promoter.
You never know. I mean, it's one of those...
That's a big what-if, because I don't think they... I think they should have... If they had the opportunity to sell it to Vince, they probably should have sold it to Vince.
Yeah.
And by the time Jarrett bought it, that thing went sideways real fast.
So. Yeah, I mean, after he bought it, it's just like you said, it went sideways. It's kind of like when, you know, the NWA got bought out and then it was World Championship Wrestling. And
yeah, let me ask you. I want to ask you about that because I think you have a good take on this. Do you think when the Turner organization bought Jim Crockett Promotion, they should have dropped the NWA name entirely and just renamed the promotion with all the championships, WCW, like right when they bought it, instead of renaming everything? Like, they did it slowly up until, like, 1991. Because for me, as a little kid watching it, I'm like, I was confused. Like, what's the NWA? Why is this WCW? And if you're trying to attract brand new fans and a national audience, you think that confused people? Because it confused me.
I think it would have definitely confused people. I mean, I would have kept it the NWA because that's what I grew up on. I mean, and it was, you know, World Championship Wrestling. It just...
That was the name of the TV show.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's just the whole thing. It was just a bad deal. I mean,
because who became NWA president after Crockett sold WCW or JCP?
Whoever it was, it kind of put it down the tube, and
There's no one left. There was no. I think the only one was left was Portland. That was it.
And
whatever little indies popped up.
Yeah, I mean, and now the NWA, you know, like we were talking about earlier in the show, it's making a comeback. So it's just weird. It's like in 2018.
Because I think that's the story that has to be told.
Yeah.
Like 88 to like 93, 94, because Crockett sells the NWA. We don't hear about what happened to the organization of the National Wrestling Alliance up until, like, Shane Douglas throws the NWA World title down in 1994.
Yeah.
So I want to know what happened in that time, like, that 6 years. Like, I want to hear that story. That's interesting.
That sounds like some investigative journalism that we're gonna put into. But kind of put a bow and a wrap on this. Next week, we're going to be talking about a show that... You think we're the only two people that actually enjoy it?
This show is regarded as one of the worst professional wrestling events of all time.
And tell our listening fans what show we'll be covering next week.
It's WCW's Great American Bash 1991. Now, a couple of reasons why this show is notable. Number one is for the amount of hate this show gets, although I do enjoy this show.
Yeah.
Number two, this is the first WCW show without Ric Flair. And we'll talk about, you know, Ric Flair's departure and the impact it had on the overall state of wrestling in general, especially WCW. So, real interesting show. It's the main event of this show is Arn Anderson and Paulie Dangerously versus Missy Hyatt and Rick Steiner.
On that really fun note, we will see you back here next week. So for Alex G, I am David Fine. Thanks for taking a trip down memory lane as we cover World Class Championship Wrestling's Parade of Champions. And as Alex G said, next week we'll be covering World Championship Wrestling's Great American Bash 1991. We will see you back here, same time, same place, next week.
You wore the family name with pride. Boldly you went forward. Did the things a lesser man might not have ever done. A tornado from the Texas plains, you came and changed our lives. Now you're gone.